Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Good morning. I'm Richard Haass, President of the Council on Foreign Relations, and I want to extend a warm welcome to everyone here this morning. Thank you for coming to our symposium on Russian-American relations. Fair warning, this event is on the record, and a request that you would please turn off your cell phones. Vibrate is not enough. It will still muck around with the sound system, so if you would turn off your cell phones, we'll have breaks in the course of the morning, so none of you will go through complete BlackBerry withdrawal, I can assure you. We meet here 2 days after the inauguration of the 44th president. And it's clear that already that the new administration has no shortage of immediate foreign policy challenges. A partial list would include Gaza, Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iran, North Korea, not to mention a backdrop of a global economic crisis. But it's important that they not allow these immediate priorities to crowd out the structural questions of America's role in the world and its ties with other great powers. And obviously one of those powers is Russia. And one of the most important relationships this country is part of is the U.S.-Russian relationship, which is our subject today. Far from receding in importance, this relationship has grown, if anything, more central to U.S. goals around the world, including energy and climate change, nonproliferation, nuclear stability, and security in Europe. At the same time, one must acknowledge that U.S.-Russian ties are severely strained. And given both the importance of the relationship and the reality of these strains, it's my view that putting Russia on any sort of back burner would be a mistake. For all these reasons, here at the Council on Foreign Relations, we're doing a good deal of work on Russia. Steve Sestanovich, here this morning, drinking coffee out of a CFR cup, which is probably as close as I will have to a legacy at this institution. Who's our George F. Kennan Senior Fellow for Russia and Eurasian Studies, in addition to organizing today's symposium, just had a piece in the November-December issue of Foreign Affairs dealing with this subject. And Jeff Mankoff, who's our Adjunct Fellow for Russian Studies, has a book coming out soon on Russian foreign policy, and I've read it. It is first rate and is a real contribution to the literature, as well as a Council special report that will be published any day now on energy issues in Eurasia. On top of all that, there's regular postings about Russia and U.S.-Russian relations on our website, cfr.org, which if you don't use as your bookmark, you should. We're here today to consider the outlook for Russia and for U.S.-Russian ties. Obviously came up in the presidential campaign. And while there's some agreement on some aspects of the relationship, there's a lot of big questions out there. Let me just rattle off a couple. How should the United States respond to the internal political changes that have occurred in recent years? To what degree should the United States be concerned with Russia's domestic character, and to what degree should it limit or at least emphasize Russia's external behavior? How should the United States handle cases where it finds this external behavior objectionable? What we've done today is structured the symposium into three parts. The first will be on Russia's economic and political outlook. And obviously, the current dual leadership faces a test from the falling energy price and from the broader economic crisis. How will the government deal with this crisis? How will this crisis affect its domestic standing? What about the role of demographic challenges, and so forth? Second session will be on Russia's foreign policy, about, again, how it will react to the economic crisis. What might Russian policy be as a result of falling energy prices? What about Russian foreign policy across the board? How does it understand its national security? How should we understand, or at least how do Russians understand, this concept of privileged interests? Last is the prescriptive session, looking at U.S. policy toward Russia. Obviously, it will include such questions as the pace and scope of NATO enlargement, Russia's relationship with NATO, missile defense, nuclear dialogue restarting, and then Russia's role in trying to address regional challenges, including but not limited to Iran. Obviously, it is a rich intellectual agenda with all sorts of policy consequences. Let me just quickly thank BP for its generous support, which really did make today's program possible, and more generally for its support in the Council across the board, helping us with our Russian program. Let me single out Rich Herold. I saw Rich this morning, and he's somewhere in this midst, in the back of the midst, for his personal involvement in what the Council does. Let me also thank our panelists and presiders. Many of you traveled a long distance to be here. We also have an extraordinary group, and obviously we'll look forward to the participation and the questions that will be part of every panel, but also in the breaks. It really is a remarkable assemblage of talent. Last but not least, it's now my pleasure to turn things over to a remarkable journalist and a good friend of the Council, David Remnick, who edits a magazine that you may have heard of called The New Yorker. David joined The New Yorker in 1998, more than a decade ago, after a decade at the Washington Post, where he served as Moscow correspondent for 4 years. Time there in Moscow led to a book that many of you, I expect, have read, Lenin's Tomb, which won the Pulitzer Prize. What you probably don't know about David is that he spent his formative months, and he would not have been the person he is today without those months at the Council on Foreign Relations, where he was the Edward R. Murrow Fellow here. So, David, thank you for presiding this morning, and thank you for turning out one of the best weekly, indeed one of the invaluable reads in this country.
Thank you very much, Richard. It's a great pleasure for me to do anything at the Council, but especially to be on a panel with Masha Lipman, whom I've known for almost all my life, it seems, who we began our relationship when she worked at the Washington Post Bureau in Moscow, and she grew out of that in about 15 minutes and became the editor of a much beloved and one of the freest publications in the history, really, of Russia, a magazine called Itogi, during the heyday of a, if not free, then close to it, free Russian press. Those days are long gone. Since then, she has been at the at Carnegie in Moscow. She is quoted more often on Russia than de Tocqueville has been quoted on the United States. She is on the speed dial, it seems, of every reporter in Moscow and anybody with an interest in Russia. She edits a magazine called Pro et Contra. And also her columns appear quite frequently in the Washington Post. Timothy Colton, who is at Harvard, is the author of many papers and books. In particular interest to me are two remarkable books. It's extremely recent biography of Boris Yeltsin, an extraordinarily hard book to do, and he accomplished it with great scholarly penetration and style. And many years ago, the author of a book that just knocked me out, a book on Moscow, an extraordinarily wide-ranging scholarly study of that city and its strange and wonderful and scary political history. Our conversation will be split in half, my conversation with our two panelists, and then your questions, which I hope will be pointed and swift so that we can get to as many people as we possibly can. Let's begin with the dead obvious, Masha. It wasn't so long ago that Russia was riding pretty high, that the Russian leadership and the Russian elites were riding even higher with soaring oil prices. Those oil prices have plunged now from $140 a barrel to $40, an enormous plunge. Economic crisis on many fronts faces Russia as it does the rest of us. What has been the upshot of this? Give us a sort of an overview of what's taken place in this very brief period of time since we've seen this plunge, this economic transformation.
Thank you. And I want to thank the Council on Foreign Relations for inviting me, and it's an honor to be here. Well, a very obvious question indeed, but not one that's easy to answer. Russia, of course, has been very badly hit by the crisis, but so have other countries. But as the famous line from Anna Karenina reads, unhappy families are unhappy in different ways, and it's interesting how what's specific, what's special about the Russian crisis as opposed to how crisis hit other countries. So one obvious thing is, of course, the price of oil. As you said, the Russian economy depends on commodity exports to a tremendous extent, oil being the most important one. And of course, this plunge from down to one-third or one-fourth of what it used to be deals a tremendous blow in the Russian economy. It leads to a production slump, has already led. It's led to people losing their jobs, the ruble devaluation, and there's a long list of economic woes that the crisis caused. Another problem related to the price of oil and the drop of the price of oil is that Putin's regime, that may be defined as an oil-greased autocracy, relies on the price of oil as a means of holding the political scene and policymaking under tight control. This is not an autocracy based on hard repression or mass-scale repression. It is mostly based on deals and contracts and buying out loyalties. And of course, it is one thing to buy loyalties when the price of oil is 140, and it's quite another matter how you do it when the price of oil has gone down and the price of metals have gone down, and the price of gas, regardless of this being the source of Russian strength, is bound to go down too. So this would be another aspect.
How would you illustrate that change? Give us an example of it.
The dominant mindset of the Russian people that may be described as a passive compliance or describe it as a non-participation pact with the government, which is we deliver improved and growing living standards, and actually Putin's government delivered like never before in Russian history. No government was as generous to the people as Putin's government was. But you, in exchange, do not meddle in politics, and the contract worked. Up to a point, the same contract has worked with between the government and the elites. We deliver good opportunities for you to enrich yourselves and to have lucrative business opportunities, but you do not meddle in our affairs. This worked too. Now, the question is whether the same kind of arrangement will continue working as smoothly with the oil price down to one-fourth, one-third of what it used to be. Another aspect of the crisis that's special, that makes Russian unhappiness different from others, is the government anti-crisis policies. Of course, there's criticism in any country that the policies are not adequate or efficient or timely, and this is also true of Russia. However, the priorities in Russia are not just questionable, but also opaque. Just like policymaking in Russia in general is opaque, what drives the measures undertaken by the government remains to be the domain of a few chosen people. Just as during the plenitudinous years, recently the decision taking has been as close as it used to be, which raises suspicion, which raises challenges the loyalty of the elites, because they suffer. And they do not know how the government is taking the decisions when it allocates rescue packages and allocates the bailouts. There is reasonable ground to believe that it is being distributed in favor of cronies. There is reasonable doubt that the government is indeed guided by a vision of how Russia would evolve from this kind of crisis, because however bad the crisis is, this is not the end of the world. Sooner or later, the crisis will be over, and Russia as a country is interested in that it becomes more viable, and the more viable industries and businesses evolve from the crisis.
Tim, do you want to address the same question, how you see it?
Well, I agree with really everything Masha said. What I would add is something about the assumptions in the ruling group and in the Russian political elite about why all this is necessary. I mean, this compact or pact with society is near the heart of the whole matter, but I think there's something which is even closer, which I think justifies in the minds of the rulers, call them that, their own position. And that is, this is a developmental autocracy, if you want to use the word autocracy, which may be a slight overstatement, but let's take it as shorthand. It's developmental, and Putin has several times...
But what's a developmental autocracy? I'm not quite...
They justify having all of those controls over everything and everyone in the name of modernizing the country. Not forever, but for a certain period of time. And Putin actually, at one point, before he stepped down as president, was challenged by, I think, a British journalist to explain how long that was going to be. And he threw out the, I'm sure you saw that, the phrase, a 15 to 20, or roughly 15 or 20 years more.
Sounds like a prison term.
Well, kind of. And he said at the end of that, though, Russia will move from this manual hands-on control over everything to a something more normal for a developed country. So therefore, I think the succession, political succession that took place last year was hooked up with that. That's how they I think, talked themselves into it. It was a sort of understanding about continuing these policies through the next decade. And of course, it was premised on growth. And so one question would be, is this going to be turned upside down if there is no growth? Just a year or so, then I'm sure they'll ride it out. But what if it turns out to be a very extended period of time? Let me throw out one other element as well, that as far as the top players are concerned, there's a little, the Kremlinology is kind of coming back into style here, but we don't really know, I don't think any of us really knows what was agreed upon at the highest level in the winter of 07-08. We know that Putin stepped down as president, that his protege became president, but what was their understanding about how what would come next? They, of course, haven't told us. My guess is that Putin didn't even tell Medvedev, partly because he may not know himself. So in terms of the mechanism of rule, who's going to be at the helm and for how long, whether Putin is indeed going to return as president, so you'll not only get the same policy, but the very same face on the television every night, this, I think, is very much an open question. And that provides, I think, a possible opening for change, because I think it is a potential source of very big political trouble. You have a triumvirate in which the senior person holds the junior office. This is not a natural arrangement. And as long as it's there, I think the possibility of cracks appearing is there, and they may even be starting to appear now.
That's certainly the structural fact, but in practice, as Russians understand who the leader of their country is, but you might begin with saying, who do Russians understand to be their leader? Superior power. And number two, where do you see this relationship going? We've seen little appearances of rhetoric from Medvedev that slightly criticized Putin. Does it matter much? What is the upshot of this entire arrangement, which is pretty confusing from a long distance?
To the question of who people regard as the senior partner in the tandem as the supreme leader. According to the polls, there is a not very different 3/3. One believing that the power, the authority is divided equally. A higher number that believes that Putin is senior, and there is still a fraction of the population who believes Medvedev is.
Didn't Georgia end this discussion? Georgia, you had the prime minister clearly leading the foreign policy and military discussions.
I think there is a desire on the part of the members of the tandem themselves, as well as a desire of the public, to see the tandem as a peaceful arrangement. As two men who have loyalty for each other, respect for each other, and who rule the country according to the same concepts and the same ideas and the same priorities. The sense is projected. It is interesting, by the way, that Russian federal television channels, which serve as the main tool to shape the public opinion, invariably, for very, very, very rare exceptions, invariably give more time to Medvedev than to Putin, according to how their jobs are arranged. However, Putin invariably remains more popular in the Russian public opinion.
And that breaks down by 80% for Putin, 70% for, from Medvedev?
Their most recent I saw, which was December, signaled a slight drop in popularity for Putin from 88 in September to 83 in December. For Medvedev, I think from 82 or 3 in September to 76 or 7 in December. So
even
pretty high.
Barack Obama has something to shoot for.
Pretty high indeed. As to the relations between the two, of course, we don't know what the arrangement was. I don't think we will ever learn. I think this is probably the most secret thing of the overall secret arrangement of how the Russian policies and Russian politics are played. However, one thing may definitely be said. Medvedev owes a lot to Putin, his presidency, his popularity, his projection to presidency. Sometime before the election, according to the polls, a vast part of the Russian population, I think over 40%, said they were ready to vote for whoever Putin recommends without even knowing the gender, the age, the appearance, or the name of that person. Mm-hmm. And sure enough, when Putin made his choice, Medvedev's popularity immediately went up with the help of the federal television news channels, but he won the election with about 70% of the vote.
Tim, did you want to add to that?
No, I think you covered it.
Okay, so what difference does it make? In other words, you have this arrangement. More or less, everything seems to be in agreement. Is there any appearance of popular public discontent with this radical shift in the economic situation in Russia? It has been the case in the last few years that it said that inside the Russian leadership, the darkest imagining is a Ukrainian scenario, some kind of popular unrest that begins to snowball and is not just isolated to a demonstration in Vladivostok, which we saw in December, but something all the more threatening, not only to local or municipal governments, but something national at the gates of the Kremlin. Tim, do you want to address this?
Well, we do have a lot of polling data, which is made available regularly, and it shows quite unambiguously that people have gone from no concern to extreme concern mm-hmm. in just a few weeks, really. Between September and December, you went from complacency, which more or less mirrored the government's attitude, to something close to panic, I think. And an interesting side piece of this is that Russians are increasingly saying to survey researchers that they don't trust what they read about the economy in the mass media, in the state-controlled media, of course. And that can't be a welcome development. As far as TV is concerned, you know, they're not fed really any other radically different information. But the fact that they're now saying that they trust it less and less, one particular survey I recall scanning within the last week or two was, I think, from the Lobota Center, but it doesn't matter. And it asked the question, do you think that the mass media are accurately reporting our economic situation? And there was a range of possible responses. But I think just shy of 50% said they didn't trust it anymore. And then there was a follow-up question which said, so why are the media not saying, speaking the truth? Is it because it's so complicated nobody could possibly understand it? Is it because the journalists don't understand it themselves? Or is it because the journalists do understand it, but they're not allowed to speak the truth? And two-thirds of the respondents gave the last of the three responses. That is, the journalists do know, just like we, in a sense, know, but they're not allowed to be frank about it. So this is, part of the environment in which these hard decisions at the top have to be made, and it's clearly spun in a dangerous direction, and it constrains, I think, what the government can do. Further, just to go back to this duumvirate business, it's not really a trivial point. You think back to the great crisis of a decade ago, 1998, 99, and what did Yeltsin and the others do? Well, they immediately started changing prime ministers. Between the spring of 1998 and the end of 1999, you had, 5 different prime ministers. Now, of course, Medvedev can't do that. In fact, he can't even criticize Putin by name. That's definitely out. And that, again, is not natural in terms of how Russian politics works. One of the few virtues, I think, of having this dual executive is that you can get a certain amount of dynamism and change through a change of prime minister. The president stays because he's popularly elected. But this president can't do that unless he thinks the unthinkable, which is to depose his patron. But I can tell you, I think this is something we should be thinking about because many Russians are starting to think that it's conceivable. Not tomorrow, but before the 2012 election.
In the Russian media, Masha, how are Russians made to understand from their leadership how this economic crisis began? Is blame directed at bankers and on Wall Street and in Washington policy? Is it centered on an American critique and therefore deflecting a more general sense of it? Or how does an average Russian or an average intelligent Russian come away from Russian television and radio and the small circulation newspapers understanding what's going on? What is their sense of why they've seen this bastion of Russian wealth, oil and gas, be degraded in terms of price?
Well, you mentioned the lower circulation Russian press, and they would give an entirely different story of the crisis and quite a lot of sensible analysis and I would say constructive critique. Just a very short while ago, the leading Russian daily, Vedomosti, ran a piece signed by five names, two of them being Mikhail Gorbachev and Alexander Lebedev, who co-owns one of the most, I would say, anti-government newspapers in Russia.
And this is the one that's buying the Evening Standard in England as well.
Yes,
former KGB agent. So.
Right, and a successful banker after that. That piece was a criticism of the government policies, not just anti-crisis measures, but the government economic policies nearly all along, and a long plan. It offered a long plan, some 15 points of how the crisis should be dealt with and what should be done for Russia to evolve as a more robust economy after the crisis is over. And actually, this piece is notable only because of the authors. However, every day on the op-ed page of that paper, there appears a piece explaining and coming up with advice and possible recommendations for the government. Now, television is a different story, of course. Television began with saying the crisis is elsewhere and Russia is a safe haven. Then we went to Russia's affected too, but we may even benefit from the crisis, and then eventually we're in crisis, and the crisis is serious. However, admitting that the crisis is here and never forgetting to emphasize that we got it like a bad disease from the promiscuous West, the coverage of the crisis, just like the coverage of the Russian politics and policymaking in general, focuses on the leaders who are in charge, who take all the right and good decisions and take good care of the public. This has been the main message and the main line guiding the coverage of policymaking in Russia for several years now, and the crisis has not changed it. And this actually works. I've also seen the polling results that indicate that people are concerned and people no longer feel secure and they're worried, but at the same time, the approval rating of the two leaders has not dropped, and dropped very insignificant.
How do you account for that?
And this is, I think there is, things may be hard, but there is a general acceptance of the political arrangement in the country. There are interesting polling results, and I think polling results are especially interesting when they show the dynamics, how the attitudes change or not change. A question has been asked by Levada Center, the best independent Russian polling center, has been asked for many years. Which political system do you like more? The one that we had under communism, the Western, however understood, or the current Russian? And just in recent years, and especially over the past two or three years, there's been a shift with the preference and a growing preference for the current. And the way Levada pollsters themselves explain it, interpret it, is the system is established, and it's established in the public minds. What's very important here, there is no alternative. The Kremlin miners, the Kremlin spin miners have seen to it that there be no reasonable, relevant political alternative insight. There is an apprehension of change, and I think there is a general readiness not for acting, maybe more effectively, maybe more actively, in order to handle the crisis. I'm talking about the public, but adjusting. Maybe things are not so good today. Maybe they will even get worse. But eventually, because the system is more or less acceptable and we'll kind of like it more than others, things will somehow gradually will take care of themselves.
But aren't they afraid the pact that you've memorably described, the non-participation pact, aren't they afraid that this will break down? In other words, under the previous arrangement of the pact, there was growing prosperity as it's buttressing it. And the growing prosperity meant that a growing middle class, upper middle class, mostly urban in its nature, people were getting on airplanes and having vacations in Cyprus and Europe and studying abroad if they were wealthier and having fresh, all kinds of things were happening in their lives that were worth saying, okay, I will ignore politics because this is coming through the door. Through my efforts, or, and even through this, even through the social system, conditions were better. Things worked a little bit better. When that starts to break down, I address this to both of you. When that starts to break down, I would imagine the non-participation pact of staying out of politics and disinterest in politics comes under threat. Seems only natural.
I think that's quite reasonable, and whether it actually works out that way, we'll have to see. But it would follow from what's already been said. That's right. So, you know, given Putin's popularity ratings, there's nowhere for them to go but down. Basically, he can't get any more popular than he was. Therefore, I think it's quite safe to expect that this will happen. But it's one thing to go from 80% to 69% and another from 80% to 49%. That would undermine the whole arrangement. Can I mention one other thing here, which is that we know, because we've done election studies in Russia going back to the early 1990s, that Russians, like most other people, are very sensitive to their economic well-being and to economic questions. So it often is largely about the economy, stupid to use our cliche. But these studies also show clearly one thing, which is that Russians are much more attuned to the condition of the country as a whole. They're more inclined to link this to their political preferences than they are to link their personal and family well-being to their political preferences. So therefore, I think management of the news is going to be extremely important here. People will put up with hard times for them for a year or two if that's all it is. That doesn't necessarily have revolutionary consequences, but if they get the impression that the situation as a whole is slipping out of control, then you could imagine this kind of cascading rather quickly, which is what happened in Ukraine. And I would remind you there, a lot of it was about transparency and the government not lying to the people. It was not really about economic catastrophe, because the Ukrainian economy was growing quite nicely in Kuchma's towards the end of his reign. So I think it would.
Are you suggesting that Orange Revolution is possible in Russia, in the Russian political context?
Well, it's possible. I don't think it's a very likely outcome anytime soon. There are lots of other things that are not present in Russia, including a private television network with editorial autonomy, which Russia used to have, but it doesn't have anymore. So I don't think it would take the form of that particular.
Same question, Masha. Is that possible? Is the Ukrainian example just far too distant and localized?
I think the simple answer is no. And I think there is an inherent difference between Russia and Ukraine. Ukraine is naturally split. Ukraine cannot be one. And there is no way,
Russia and Ukraine. Within
East
Ukraine,
east and west.
I was talking about Ukraine that is split, that has not evolved as one nation yet. The question is whether it will with time. But in Ukraine, there is no way for the government to say those who are against us are the enemies of the people, are exaggerated a great deal. This is not the message that the Russian government is sending. But this is the implication that loyalty is the order of the day, and everyone is supposed to support the government, and the government is there forever. In Ukraine, there is no way to say those who disagree are the enemies of the people, because they are the people. And Ukraine, being between Russia and the West in many different ways, has this potential of a political difference and of a political conflict. And because the conflict is inherent and will always be there, at least for the conceivable future, the need for a compromise is imminent. And the politicians there need to come to terms. They do so badly, but they do so as an ongoing simmering conflict, not as a civil war, not in terms of one totally dominating over the other and declaring the other the enemy of the people. Now, if I can go back a little bit to the question of people are discontent. There's this difference that you mentioned between what life used to be and what it is now. And by the way, the number of people who travel abroad, I wonder if the audience would guess here what is the percentage. I will not ask for your guesses. It is under 10%. It's a tiny fraction of the population, as in any big country, I think in this country as well. Not too many people travel abroad.
Half our Congress doesn't travel abroad.
I think... it may come to the coverage of the federal television is so dramatically at variance with the everyday lives of the people that it might create a problem, and federal television channel will no longer be the tool of reliably ensuring stability. But we're not there yet. We definitely are not. And the cushion that the government accumulated, thanks to reasonable policy of the Minister of the Finance, is still squandered. Part of it has been squandered, and critics say in a quite inefficient way, but there is still a lot there. And if the government plays it wisely, I think it can still rely on this, if not loyal, then compliant mindset and the readiness for adjustment. Where the problem arises or is more likely to arise is not from the grassroots, is not from the public discontent that will channel itself into politics, because Putin's policy over the years ensured that this would not happen. There are no channels. There are no institutions. But the elites themselves at the top that are not won, that are notoriously torn by conflict, and that have preferred to regard Putin as the ultimate arbiter and the ultimate authority over the years, may actually be getting different ideas if Putin's popularity goes down. Then this loyalty as the order of the day may not be paying off the way it did. And the mindset of being risk averse that dominated the Russian elites for many years may actually change for something else, for considering that maybe political risk coming together and offering and trying to probably shape the Russian development in a different way may be worth it.
Tim, you've made your scholarly part, at least part of your scholarly work, about political struggle and democratization and political diversity in Russia, particularly after 1989, 1991. And yet, in 2008, we get a poll in which the most popular Russians are, the Russian populace is asked, who are your favorite Russians of all time, historically? And coming in third is Joseph Stalin. And it's not as if he was exceeded by Andrei Sakharov. I think in first place was Alexander Nevsky, and I don't know who came in.
Stalipin.
Well, that's the business class speaks. So, what does it represent to you that Stalin persists as such a popular marker in Russian psychology? And how does this affect the discussion that we've been having for a little while? And by the way, after this little go-around, we'll get your questions, please.
Well, it's a very good question. This poll, you have to realize, was not scientific, so it's not as if they polled the population in a rigorous way. It was a kind of go to a website, or it was done very. People selected themselves into the reference group. So, whether a rigorous sociological survey of Russians would show Stalin at so high a level, I wouldn't be entirely sure. But it's impossible to deny that many Russians do admire him, and that perhaps the trend is towards greater appreciation of what Stalin did. And I guess I would try to link this up with what's happened in the last decade, the return of the state, rebuilding the state, the sort of premise being that Russia cannot be governed any way other than with quite a strong hand. Stalin also not only kept the empire together, but he enlarged it. Ukrainians should be grateful to him for that, actually, because they benefited greatly. I think this also plays into it.
Marsha, same question.
I generally agree. I think this is the main point. I think it is very important. By the way, in the polls, Stalin figures as high or higher as number one, two, or three, depending on the time. And
that comes as an enormous relief.
I didn't mean it as a relief. Yeah. Anyhow, I think it is important. This important reservation should be made. When Stalin is worshipped, or should I say admired, by a majority of the Russian people, he is not admired as a tyrant. He is admired as a symbol. As a symbol of exactly what to mention.
But a государственник, a state builder.
Absolutely. He is the embodiment of the Russian statehood, which should not be questioned. And the Russian statehood under Stalin was that of a state that was victorious in World War II, of a state that held sway of over half the world afterwards. It may be hard to figure for people outside of Russia, but if people are asked in the polls about the year 37, and lots of polls were taken on the year of the anniversary, 2007, the year, of course, of the peak of mass repressions in the USSR. People abhor these events, and so does Putin. And he doesn't mind saying, as he did, taking part in the funeral service the mourning of the victims, that year was the year of horror, was the year of lunacy, was the year when the Russian state was exterminating its own citizens. Now, how do the two come together? How do the two converge? This is because Stalin is the embodiment of the state, not of the repressions. And so he is to Putin. The state should not be questioned. This is the foundation of Putin's regime. And this is what actually is in common between his regime and Stalin.
Great. We'll start with a question here. Please give us your name and any affiliation that you might like to share or advertise.
Carter Page, Global Energy Capital. My question relates to sort of the tone and the focus of your remarks, which was a little bit of a glasses half empty view of the current situation. You know, there are a lot of other perspectives in terms of potential ways where growth is possible and further development is possible in Russia. You know, a lot of the points you made, you know, the cracks in the regime, potential, things that the Kremlin spinmeisters are doing. What do you see as some of the potential opportunities for driving the process forward? And I just think there's a bit of a strange juxtaposition between this conversation in the last presentation at the Council on Russia, where President Medvedev actually talked about several of those points. So I'm just curious to get your thoughts on that.
Tim?
We are in a very open-ended situation right now. And certainly the idea that growth will resume in Russia is not an outrageous one. But the question is really when. And can it be sustained in the form that it took during the Putin decade? And I think what many Russians now fear is that the when is going to be quite some time from now, and also that it may not be sustainable any longer in the form that it took during the Putin decade, with this extreme reliance on hydrocarbons, among other things, with enormous price volatility. Now, Putin here has always talked the right game. He has been in favor of diversification. From the very beginning, this word crosses his lips regularly. He is also in favor of fighting corruption. But when asked on the way out the door what was the greatest failing of his regime, he said, "We didn't do anything about corruption." So, you know, it is a state-directed, sort of deformed market economy, but with certain features of a market economy. And it's extremely corrupt. And so my guess is that in order to get back to those higher growth rates, certainly if attracting foreign capital is part of the picture, that some features of the model are going to have to be modified. and modernized and opened up.
Bill Drozdiak?
Bill Drozdiak, the American Council on Germany. If Putin and Medvedev have managed to escape responsibility, as you suggest, do you see among the public a rising nationalist fervor to look abroad for scapegoats that could then be exploited by the leadership in terms of a more aggressive foreign policy as a way of turning the public attention away from problems at home and directing their wrath abroad?
Well, to begin with, I want to emphasize also that it's open-ending, and we've ended a period of insecurity. So growth is possible. I'm sorry, I'm addressing the previous question a little bit. And one of the progressive ministers in Putin's government, Medvedev's government, Putin's cabinet, said not a long time ago that the current model of development, of growth, has exhausted itself. Now, the question is, what next? And is the current government able to actually scrap the current model and start a new one? And this is this looks doubtful to me. Now, nationalism has been exploited, and regarding the West as the source of woes for Russia, as a force, very broadly speaking, West, as a force that seeks to harm Russia, I think has been part of the Russian foreign policy for a while. I wouldn't say Russia is solely to blame.
In this case, not without justification.
Exactly. I was going to say, in this case, Russia is not solely responsible for it. I think the relations between Russia and the West have developed in a fairly unfortunate way over the past years, but I will leave this to the foreign policy panel. Is it possible to capitalize on it more? Of course. I think it's gone up and down depending on the relations, depending on the developments in the world. And if, for example, you look at a projection of the Russian foreign policy in the public opinion, you can see negative peaks, bottom peaks, of the negative attitude toward the West in time for the bombing of Yugoslavia, in time for the launch of the war in Iraq. On those moments when Russia regarded that it was being ignored, its opinion being waved off, and the West was acting on itself. This is not to say that something like this is about to happen. I hope not. I hope for more reasonable and rational policies with regard to Russia on the part of the new administration. But what I'm saying here is this: the relations are not stable, and the policy of scapegoating the West and of vilifying the West also has gone up and down. The down phase has lasted longer this time than it did on previous occasions.
Okay. This woman here, and then Igor Malashenko, and then here.
My name is Barbara Kellerman. I'm at the Harvard Kennedy School. My question really is also a little bit about your presentation, which was very much old school in that it talked about traditional media and the Kremlin way of controlling what's happening in Russia. But those days are, at least to a modest degree, even in Russia, past. And I wondered if you'd comment both on demographic changes, particularly the youth, and also technology. This is not the old media. This is the age of the internet, the cell phone, email, and all those other obvious technologies. And I wonder if you would comment on the impact both of demographic changes, cultural changes, and also technological
changes. Masha, who's very involved with the press and has been for years, can answer that. I think let's stick to the question.
Thank
of the
you
internet.
For the question. Indeed, this is an age of technology and digital television and the web and the rest. However, the Russian media scene is arranged in a fairly sophisticated way. Politically from the point of view of the Russian government. All these modern media do offer an entirely different picture of the Russian life. Print, web, radio, even smaller audience television to some extent. The fact of the matter is that politically, that's zero relevance. And if you look at how people vote, the predominant vote for the pro-Kremlin Единая Россия, United Russia Party is a good example, but in fact, however you look, if you look at the attitudes, and Levada Center pollsters have shown this in a very graphic way, the Russian attitudes are a projection of the message of federal television. This is a factor of the audience. The audience of federal television is almost 100% of the Russian households, where all the rest, of course, fade compared to that. But it's not just that. It's a matter of how the political scene is organized. It's a matter of no institutions. And if these elements of free media operate in an unfree political environment, there is no way for a political news reported to become a political event. There is no parliament. There is no opposition in the parliament to raise an issue that is reported in all those media. There is no independent court to examine a case, a political sensitive case. Overall, this mindset of passive compliance, which results in that there is low demand for alternative sources of information. It's not that people do not have sources. This is not the Soviet Union. There's plenty of sources. However, if you look at the attitudes and their reactions, they are guided by the federal coverage, not by, by all those more media.
Tim, you want to add something quick, and then we'll go Igor, and then
sure. These are reasonable points, Marsha, but I think we should not forget some of the lessons of history here. After all, the Soviet regime had ironclad control over information flow of the type that we're talking about here. Eventually, it loosened its grip, and then it lost control. But it loosened its grip partly because people had started to disbelieve the official media. So,
but didn't it loosen its grip partly by edict of after the death of Stalin and the rise of Khrushchev and an edict from the Kremlin?
Well, leaders are always going to be involved in making changes in any country, but certainly in Russia.
Would there have been a thaw without Khrushchev?
Well, who knows? Yeah. I think there probably would have had to be, but it might have taken a different form, of course.
Okay. Yes, right there.
My name is Igor Malashenko, and I would identify myself as a Ukrainian with Russian passport living in the United States, if I may. I have an old school question. Mostly for Masha, I believe. You mentioned Russian elite a number of times. Don't you have a feeling that there is no elite in Russia in Western sense, that Russian elite is basically a contradiction in terms, and it probably tells volumes about Russia's past, present, and future? Thank you.
This is a grand question. Thank you. I wonder what is there in Russia that has the same name as a Western institution but is different in substance? I think whatever you take.
Coffee.
Starbucks has come to Moscow, by the way, and I think it's the same. It's still the same coffee. Actually, consumption standards have come to Russia, and they've taken a good route, which is not true of institutions, and which is not true. I think this is a very profound question indeed. Yes, the elite is different in a sense that the elite, even the most advanced, the most enlightened, the wealthiest, the most entrepreneurial, have reconciled to the political configuration offered by the current regime. They don't mind being underrepresented, and they don't mind living in a situation when they are at the mercy of the government, no matter how many millions or billions of dollars or rubles or whatever they've made. And the example of Mikhail Khodorkovsky shows how it is achieved. Only one of the methods, but actually not a minor one. However, I think that, and we always come down to the same question, is it going to be like this forever? And we don't know. I think we both agree that this is, Russia has ended a period of especial uncertainty. Russia has been unpredictable or very hard to predict for a long time, and now I think that this time is especially uncertain. However, when you live in a situation of this imposed stability or oil grease stability for over 8 years now, it is very hard to envision where change might come from. It might. I don't rule it out. I think it is possible, and I think the elites, however defined, however different from the Western concept, is the likeliest source of this change.
Sir? There's a microphone.
I owe a lot of BP shares and MTO, and I'm particularly interested in that aspect. But the key is, you know, to our discussion, we were supposed to look at the economic outlook, and we so far have not really attached. We just touched it a little bit by Tim. There's a profound change in this country. We do nationalized bank. We might call it something else. We are maybe experiencing general crisis of capitalism. We are not calling it yet like that, but I feel the worst. In Russia, it's of course much worse because of the two factors which you have written about in your writing. One is of course that the country has been petroleum industry oriented. It doesn't have the multiple industrial complex like here. And secondly, the way how is it run with the oligarchs, there's no shareholders meetings. It's decided still in that Leninist way from the center with a coalition of former KGB agents and, of course, the oligarchs. Therefore, Russia is facing much worse even, a deeper economic crisis. And it's already shows in her behavior. You know, they send all these hardware and naval ships through Panama and send some oil to Polyevs.
But sir, with respect, what's
the question? Thing is that we are not going to see any more interventions in Georgia. What we are seeing is a profound retreat.
Sir, your question.
The question is, do you agree with me that the crisis, that the crisis is such that there will be rarely any more expansion? They are much more careful. They are much more skillful. They are manipulating Ukraine in a very
okay.
Is that what is in the cards?
Tim.
In other words, Steve's article is irrelevant.
Well,
Steve can speak for himself.
We'll be discussing this more fully later this morning. But I mean, certainly resources are going to be scarce for the foreseeable future. So some of the wilder schemes that we heard about a year ago, six aircraft carrier groups within 20 years and all this stuff, are going to be put in a very deep freeze at the back of the safe somewhere. On the other hand, I would not myself infer from economic stringency that Russian behavior in its immediate neighborhood on issues that its leaders feel are vital to Russia's security, and even, they say, to its existence as a state, in the case of Ukraine, that its behavior will necessarily be all that restrained. I mean, I think if the Georgia crisis had occurred this winter with this recession underway, the Russians would have behaved in exactly the same way.
Sir. Could you wait for the microphone? There you go.
Roswell Perkins, a retired lawyer. My question relates to the middle class. Back in 1998, the middle class was very small, relatively speaking, and now it has grown. And can you comment on the difference in the two economic crises as relates to the growth of the middle class during this period and how much the effect on the middle class is affecting
between 1998 and 2008.
Exactly.
Good question, Masha.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I want to go back to Igor Volchenko for a second. When we say middle class, we need to figure out what we actually imply. And we shouldn't actually imbue the Russian middle class with the sort of attitudes that the Western middle class has. Most importantly, what the Russian middle class, which I would prefer to call medium income group, people with relatively decent consumption and living standards, consumption more than living. But what they lack is the psychology of taxpayers, which assume, ideally, that they vote for the government spends their taxpayer dollar or euro, whatever, and if the government doesn't do this in the right way, they will vote it out. This is what is missing from the Russian scene. This being said, people in modern industries, let's put it this way, who had very good opportunities in the year 97 and still in early 98 and then lost a lot, were a small group and B, they were mostly very young people. And actually, this was not a very hard blow. It lasted for maybe, well, differed for several years, two for some, and then they found new jobs, and those industries began to develop anew. Today, we're talking about a bigger group, people who enjoy those living and consumption standards, which does not mean that their mindset and their attitude is so different from the rest of the population. I think they, too, would actually, unless something that unforeseeable is in store for Russia, they, too, will be tuned to adjustment.
We have time for one more question, and there was somebody over here. Right, yes.
Thank you. Tim Snyder, Yale University. I wanted to ask a question about a very traditional state-controlled medium, namely the school textbook. It's prompted by Ukraine. Many of the Orange Revolutionaries had read as their main school history textbook something that was originally written and published in Canada. I wanted to ask what the degree of control the central Russian state is over school textbooks, especially history, if this frames public opinion and has anything to do with continued veneration of Stalin.
I think both of you, if you want to take a short crack at that, and then we'll conclude. Masha?
This is a big issue in Russia. There is especially one textbook that you probably have in mind. You probably know what you're talking about, a textbook for high schoolers about 20th century Russian history, which draws a portrait of Stalin as exactly what I was saying earlier, the embodiment of statehood, a good government manager, etc. This has caused a lot of scandal. This is deplorable that such a textbook should appear. However, one minor consolation is that it ended up not as a school textbook, whether or not because of the public scandal is hard to say. However, it ended up as a manual for teachers, which doesn't make it as mandatory as it would be as a book. Also, a few years ago, there was an idea to impose a single textbook for history. For the whole country, the way it was in the USSR, so that there would be no choice. This has not happened. This initiative has never come true. What drove it, whether the leaders are reasonable, whether the public outrage worked, is hard to say. However, it's not as bad as probably your question implied that it is.
Tim, a final word on this question of history?
Well, I've not read these textbooks myself, so I can't say too much about their content.
But you were saying before we came on, I asked you if your Yeltsin biography had been translated, and in fact that you were both saying that there really is no scholarly political writing as such.
Well, I think if we're talking about post-Soviet history, the history of the post-Soviet two decades, that there's very little that Russians have done. Other than memoirs, that's worth reading. I mean, it's just there's not been a lot of serious work done, certainly on political trends. But on the other hand, if a foreigner has a book that for which there would be a Russian audience, there's really no political impediment that I'm aware of to it being published there. In my own case, the problem with the Yeltsin book is that it's rather long, and it's more a financial question. The political side hasn't even come up in conversation.
Tim Colton, Masha Lipman, thanks very much, and thank you.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.